Welcome.
Look at that, still got it.
Still got it.
Still
got it.
Still, thanks for that. Still got it, haven't I?
Right.
Isn't it lovely to see me? Thank you.
We've cuffed them to the chairs so they can't storm the stage.
First things first, how's the mullet going?
Mullet's coming on all right, actually. I'm thinking of tapering this down at the sides for the game on Saturday.
Oh, yes.
I don't know, but I actually was going to do full mullet with a wig, and I tried the wig on today, and it just looks too ridiculous. So, but I do have a fake moustache that I could wear, right. Genuinely. But I'm not sure if I'll be using it or not. We'll see.
So you're performing at the grand final on Saturday. Are you stoked? Excited?
I am. I'm very much excited. Yeah, I just did rehearsals with the lovely Delta Goodrum. It's a big do. It's massive, and it feels really cool to be part of the heritage of Australian sports. I get it. I get how big this day is. In fact, you have your own. You have. Is it called a bank holiday? Do you call it a bank holiday?
No, we don't call it a bank holiday.
Public holiday. Okay, so you have a public holiday for the game.
Yeah.
That's how much you guys love sport. I love that.
But not even on the day of the game.
The day before.
We've got to get ready.
Yeah.
And we know you love your AFL because last time you spoke to Waleed, and I was very excited to hear this. Let's play a little clip of your love of the Collingwood Football Club. Let's have a look.
They're a working-class club and they're very aggressive towards the opposition.
Yeah.
What's bad about either of those things?
Ooh.
I don't get it.
Now, like me, Robbie, you would have been devastated at the 1-point loss last week. And we can't go through all the details. I know you would like them to have done different things in the last minute. But are you still backing the Pies in next year?
Well, I did watch that game. I did watch that game. And what I thought was, I bet you the people that run the AFL wish that that game was the final.
It was pretty amazing.
I'll ask you a question, because finals in the UK with, you know, the Champions League final or the FA Cup final with soccer, they're always a bit drab. Mm. Are finals a bit drab here, or can they get tasty and are they exciting?
The grand final is often not great, but sometimes it's incredible.
Yes.
And I've got a feeling this year might be one of those.
Well, the coach of Carlton came round to see me.
And brought
me a shirt.
No, don't.
No, genuinely.
Robbie, we had you to. You love the Pies.
I do love the Pies because of the black and white.
Yes.
Yeah, I like it because of the black and white.
You're wearing red and black right now.
Yeah, but I've been indoctrinated now. the Pies didn't send their coach round to see me. And that's how easily persuaded I am.
He was busy winning Coach of the Year. That's the thing.
Said you'd like the working class club. You've literally gone for the toffee Tory club now.
Well, you know, that's what happens when you get famous in showbiz. When you do well, you betray your roots. How easily that happened. Look at that.
The other thing we spoke about was you were determined to be like the global ambassador for the sport.
Yeah.
I think this is a wonderful initiative. Have you planned out your program? Is this weekend's performance the starting point?
I've had second thoughts about that. I'm very busy. No, it's not that. It's just that I kind of get your sport and I understand, like, for example, the Premiership game ends and the players do interviews and they're terrified of the press, they're terrified of saying the wrong thing, and they're getting paid an absolute fortune and have never been so far away from the fans and the working man, right? Mm-hmm. When I watch your players for the AFL do interviews after the game, it's like somebody from the stands came down and played in the game. This is true. Right, now, so what I think about the sport is it's underserved. It's underserved. There should be a World Cup, there should be a UK team, there should be Spanish teams, and it should be massive. But that being said, if that happens, expansion will kill the game. So I think I'm not going to help. I'm not going to help because I don't want to ruin your game. I don't want to take it away from the fans.
I'm helping by not helping. It's very wise.
You've just announced a massive tour for next year. You're doing winery shows.
Am I?
Yeah.
I'm a recovering alcoholic too. How great is that? We might as well go down to Colombia as well, finish the whole thing off. doing gigs in the forest.
They probably should have mentioned that to you, Robbie. Yeah. The boozy crowds make for better audiences. Are they boozier at wineries or...?
It just depends on the day and it depends how hot it's been and it depends how long they've been there. I've done the wineries before and some of the crowds... They're a bit different. But, you know, most of the time at the wineries, the crowds are absolutely incredible. But if it's been piping hot for the day and they drink all day, they're a bit woozy. They get a bit woozy. They're really into the ballads but can't be bothered with the others.
Can you hear the slurring when they sing?
It's just... Look, it's just so sloppy. come and see it happen.
We're very excited about the 25, the album coming out. The album cover, we have a pic of the album cover. I mean, this is... It's. I mean, you put yourself on a pedestal and you're naked. That's confidence, Robbie.
That's... The funny thing is that I wasn't even a photo shoot. They just came round at my house. They just came round at my house and just took pictures of whatever it was I was doing. That's how I spend my days.
Well, you're giving the fans what they want.
Exactly.
Do they though?
I mean, you know, this is middle age. This is what this is now. But the thing is about that photo shoot, it was a very cold day. Genuinely was a cold day and there was just like a modesty pouch. And it wasn't just that photographer. There was like 30 strangers in a room, really cold, looking at me naked. And it was another one of those moments where I was like, this is a very interesting job I've given myself.
Well, I don't want this to sound creepy, but I feel like there could be some volunteers in the audience next time you do have a photo shoot like
that. Bless you, thank you.
But, Robbie, you've actually credited Australian crowds and audiences with giving you the passion or bringing the passion back for performing. Where did it go?
That was a lie I said in an interview. No, it didn't go. It wasn't about the passion coming back. Mm. Not that wasn't the case. It was like, I did two gigs in Melbourne at the Rod Laver just recently. And after COVID, I was stood at the back, first big gigs back, and I just looked at the audience and all of a sudden it became a massive room full of lots and lots of people that have turned up to see me, that have left their houses and booked babysitters and whatever. And genuinely, without sounding over-sincere, because you can go around the world and you can become a bit blasé. Not that you don't respect it or love it or are grateful, but it's just another room full of people or a stadium full of people. And then there was like a real moment of clarity where it was like, wow, I'm so lucky. Mm-hmm. And I don't like sincerity, but there you go. I gave it a good go.
Will your fans travel out with you next year when you come tour?
I really hope so. The kids are all homeschooled right now because I don't want to be that dad that when they're 20, 21, they've never met me. And my job, fortunately and unfortunately, means I'm never in one place long enough. So at the minute they're homeschooling and they can come with me. My wife they need a high school experience. I'm like, they really don't. You know, I don't know. I just want them to be with me all the time. There I go, being sincere again.
I was going to say, what's happening?
Two in an interview.
Hey, it looks like you passed down your musical genes too. There was a video of Teddy playing, like, amazing. I think we've got a little bit of it here. I mean, is this the future, the Williams future we're looking at here?
Yeah, she's, unbelievable. She has been singing and making up songs since she could talk, and she's really progressed from there now. There's no stopping her. She, fortunately and unfortunately, once again, she's going to be in this industry. She's very much got jazz hands. She came out the womb with jazz hands, which was very painful for the wife.
Mate, we're so stoked to have you back in the country. You shot your biopic here. I was at Rod Laver Arena when you shot some stuff for that night, for the movie. Is it true? It sounds like you're swinging for the fences in this biopic. Is it true that you're played by an ape, like a CGI?
I cannot confirm or deny that. But like,
have you heard that rumor?
I do like taking big swings, and yes, I have heard that rumor. I just love things with tons of jeopardy, and everything that I do has tons of jeopardy because I don't know what I'm going to do or say next. Mm. And so it is with the film too. What we're doing is a big swing. But I've seen rushes, I think they call it in the film industry, mm-hmm. and I'm very confident that we've got something very special.
If there was an ape, would the ape have tats as well, or is it a tatless ape?
I don't know. Like I say, I can neither confirm or deny.
What I love is that you're unable to deny that you will be an ape in this film.
Yeah.
That's remarkable. Mm-hmm. You can't deny that.
I think, look, you know, there's so much money and time gone into this film that whatever we are doing with it, we have to go over the hill all together with the press and the promotion and the everything all at once. So I don't want to release any spoilers. But at the end of the film, I survive. I don't die. Oh. I can tell you that now. In the middle, you might worry about me, but it's fine. I'm here. Look.
I think there's some people in the audience that just went, oh, thank goodness. Oh, thank God. He gets out safely. Obviously, so many fanatical fans here that will come up to you whenever you leave. Is there anyone, though, that you are starstruck by in your life at this stage?
Which one's the main Hemsworth?
Chris.
Yeah. We love all of them.
You have both of them.
But you're obviously decent.
Chris, right?
Yeah, Chris, yes.
Yeah, it was a weird thing. I was, like, at the Beverly Hills Hotel and I was walking out and there was Chris and then I was just like... I couldn't look at him in the eye. Like, I'm a heterosexual guy, but I was just like...
Did you talk to him in the
end? I didn't know what to say.
So
I invited
him
to my show. I was like, will you come see my show? I'd love you to be there. I'd do He's the One for you. Yeah, so he made my tizzer go foo, yeah.
Speaking of stars, I interviewed Mel C last week. She's got a memoir out. Did you know that?
Yeah, I do. I do know she's got a memoir out because I watched her do a podcast the other night and she was brilliant on it. She spoke very honestly and, you know, she's obviously had to examine her life and how she feels and how she responds to herself and the world around her. And she's done an amazing job. I wanted to get hold of her and just say, you did a great job on that podcast.
Well, yeah. She spoke very fondly of you. Ask her because I didn't know that you guys had a brief fling and I did ask her about that fling.
This book's coming out and I think Robbie's got a record coming out as well, so it's like, oh, my gosh, he's been quiet for years and then all of a sudden it's like, hey, we're doing a show together in a few weeks, I'm going to go like that. You might want to read chapter...
Well, because you do say at the end that he wasn't that lovely at the end. Does he know he wasn't that lovely?
Oh, yeah. And he's apologised to me and a lot of water's, you know, gone under the bridge.
Yeah.
Have you got your advance copy and have you read that?
No, I haven't. But I can say what I just said and then leave it at that. No.
I can't wait to see the CGI gorilla in that scene.
Okay, it's a monkey.
Hey, one of the things, though, talking to her, and you just touched on it then, I was a massive Spice Girls fan at the time, massive Take That fan, but I never realised as the fan what was going on for the artists behind the scenes. And so many artists now talk about how that time was torturing for them.
It's absolutely crazy. If you take any boy band or any girl band and sit them down, each individual member will have a traumatic horror story. Mm. And you take that, for example. You've got Gary Barlow's talked about his bulimia and his depression. And, you know, he put on a load of weight after the band finished and couldn't leave the house and couldn't write songs, didn't know how to do it because, you know, his career was supposed to do this and my career was supposed to do whatever and it went the opposite way. Then you've got Howard in the band that wanted to commit suicide after the band ended. Then you've got Mark, who's been to rehab and has had his own demons. And then you've got Jason that just can't be in the band at all, can't be anywhere near it. And then if you take that story with that band and then if you replicate it with the Spice Girls too, I'm sure that you will have a similar sort of story. It's incredible, you know, and I'm truly grateful that it happened to me, how it happened to me, and I'm still dumbfounded that nice things keep happening to me and I've got this album out and everything. But it is, there should be a sort of an examination into this, like a documentary of, okay, what is it that it does? What is it that it does to your insides? Why does it do that? And why are these people responding in this way to what's happening to them?
I find
it fascinating.
Can you be that famous and not have something like that happen along the way?
I don't think you can because I play this game. Name me not a mentalist.
Name me not a mentalist.
Name me not a mentalist. The only person we can come up with is Tom Hanks. Mm. But he might just be very good at acting. Seriously, though, it's like anybody that's had that sort of level of fame foisted upon them, or they've seeked it out and they've got it, nobody comes through it unscathed or well. Nobody deals with it well, you know. But
it is interesting.
Yeah. I find it fascinating.
And it's so great to hear you speak about that. Hey, I'm afraid we're running out of time.
Is that it?
I think one more question.
What's you that has to go, not us?
But I love asking thoughtful musicians this, and I think you are that, because you've spoken about how Angels is the best song you've ever written. I wonder, is there a song you hear and you wish you'd written that? You hear it and you go, oh, God, I wish that was mine.
Yeah, all the time.
Is there a particular one?
There's actually so many on a day-to-day basis. And, you know, it's like I have a touch of the jealousies going on. There's loads and loads and loads. First one that comes to mind is Yellow by Coldplay. That's the first one, but that's not the only one.
Right.
It happens every day. All day.
Well, Pete's written a song he would like to show you.
Oh, yeah. We've got the piano here.
We
haven't got it.
Well, it's your music that we love. Your Aussie tour kicks off in November 2023, but tickets go on sale next Friday, September 30, so get ready. Head to our website for details on how to snatch them up. It's been so good.